Hello, sermon number 66 from True Love Chapel, and thank you for joining us. We're based out of Las Vegas, Nevada. We are going through the Bible, following a reading plan you can find out about on the website, truelovechapel.com. And, you know, we want to learn the Bible better, and we want you to join us, and please do so. You know, it's good for Christians to every year study through the Bible every year. And so, you know, if you're not in the Word, you need to get there. Just pick up where we're at and let's just get going. And we're going to be in Luke chapter 9 today. And let's pray. Almighty God, thank you, God, for another Bible study, another sermon. And God, please, God, really lead me with the Holy Spirit. Let me preach the message that you want me to preach. And we pray for your blessing to be upon us. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, so Luke chapter 9, it's going to be verses 57 to 62. In the NASB, the heading is Exacting Discipleship. Okay? And it goes like this. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "The foxes have holes, and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." And he said to another, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, permit me first to go and bury my father." But he said to him, "Allow the dead to bury their own dead. But as for you, go and proclaim everywhere the kingdom of God." Another also said, "I will follow you, Lord, but first permit me to say goodbye to those at home." But Jesus said to him, "No one, after putting his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God." This is, you know, this is what we're talking about here. Let's just jump into it. You know, the cost of discipleship. It's free. Is it free? Salvation is free. You don't have to earn it. You just receive it. It's a gift from God that you receive. Freely, but you don't deserve it. You don't deserve your salvation. It's something that God gives you by grace, received through faith in Jesus Christ. So we don't deserve it. We didn't earn it, but God gives it to us. God gives us eternal life. That's what he wanted us to have. That's what we're created for. We're created to have fellowship with God for all eternity. To have this love relationship with God. I mean, God himself is love, right? God is love. You can say God is love. The Bible says that in 1 John. And how is God love? I mean, well, love, it comes from God and it is God. God's characteristic, it's one of his characteristics is love. And so you have the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. They have existed together forever, for all eternity. And then there's this perfect love, this perfect unity within the Godhead, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So that all of that equals one God in perfect unity. There's one God. But there's a love relationship even within God himself, his own nature. And so we recognize love as something being good, right? Hate is bad. It's not good to hate people. It is good to love people. We recognize that. There's just sort of a natural thing about that. Just a universally accepted, you know, you don't have to be taught that. You know what's good and what's bad, right? You know that it's good to love and it's bad to hate. And then our natural proclivity is going to be towards hate more so than love. I mean, because we're sin, we're flawed. We're a, you know, a sinful creation. We're all born with this sin nature in us. And so here it is. Jesus is, you know, in Luke chapter 9, we're in the heart of Jesus' ministry. And so Jesus being the Son of God and being God himself. So Jesus is God in the flesh. It's that aspect of God that you can see when he comes, you know, in the flesh as a human. Jesus being fully God and fully human. You know, the Father is in the Son is in the Father, the Holy Spirit is in the Son and the Father. It's all the same. It's all connected. And it's mysterious. We're not going to completely understand God, you know, but we're learning. So at any rate, Jesus came to seek and save the lost, right? He also said that he came not to bring peace, but division, right? What does that mean? Well, to make you decide, are you going to be with him or against him? Because this life isn't it. This life is just an intermediary type of situation where, you know, we're here just to decide where we're going to spend eternity. And that's it. Now, once we've made that decision, God keeps us here. You know, as Christians, we've decided to spend our eternity with Christ and with God in heaven for eternity. Having made that decision, we're still here for a purpose, and that is to spread the gospel to others so that others can hear our witness. And our witness is just one more drop in the bucket. All the evidence is there, but people don't always, you know, who knows what's the thing is that's gonna convince them, and it's the Holy Spirit. We're just here to be a vessel for God to work through and for the Spirit to work in us and through us, reaching other people, pointing them to Jesus. You know, it's the Holy Spirit that draws them. We can only point people to Jesus with our life and our ministry. And so when we look at this, you know, exacting discipleship, the cost of discipleship. So he said it's free, but it will cost you everything. I mean, it will take over your life. But that's the thing. It's the great reversal. Our reward is in heaven. We've purposely suppressed, you know, we've declined from receiving our reward here on earth, and we've chosen to seek and pursue the reward in heaven. And so we're here on earth on a mission. We're here to work and to do the work for the kingdom of God. And like where he said, you know, as for you, go and proclaim everywhere the kingdom of God. Well, let's start at verse 57. We'll start at the beginning. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. So Jesus and the disciples are walking along the road, and someone sees them and just shouts out to Jesus saying, I will follow you wherever you go. Okay. That might have been a great thing, and it is a great thing. It is a great thing to say and to hear. But Jesus knows the intention of the heart. So it's not enough to just say you will go with him wherever you go. Jesus calls him out, more or less. It's like, do you know the cost? Do you know what you're getting into? You know what I mean? You need to count the cost. When he says in verse 58, Jesus said to him, the foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. You know, it sounds like, what is he saying? He's saying it's going to be hard. You're going to follow Jesus. It's not going to be easy. Foxes have holes. Birds have nests, right? They have their place in the world, and they fit, and they belong. You know, a fox or a bird up in the nest, you know, it's its own little place, and this is it. It's comfortable where it's at. It probably has no idea about the greater picture of things. It's just comfortable in its own little space, and that's it. It's just, you know, nothing to it. But the Son of Man, it says, has nowhere to lay his head. Now, that may have been a literal true statement at this point. Jesus was preaching all over the place, all over the region. And, you know, he was staying at people's houses that would accept him. You know, they didn't, they, hotels back then were not so nice. It was usually a place of ill repute. And so traveling, well, people that were just like, I guess, decent people, they're not looking for like a brothel or something. They're just looking for a place to sleep. And so they would stay at people's houses. There's the hospitality side of things, which is very big, very valued back then. So anyway, he's saying he has no place to live. You know, every place he's wandering, and that's the life. He's wandering. He has no comfortable place to just settle down and relax. He's on the move. He's doing the work of God, and it's tough. You know, it's not easy. Logistically, there's just a lot of stuff, right? One night you might have a nice place to sleep. Another night you might be sleeping outside, literally, right? And you just don't know. Well, I mean, God's going to provide everything you need, but it's going to be a lot of ups and downs. And you're just not going to fit in. You're not going to fit in the world. If you're a Christian and you're living like a Christian, that's the big difference. If you're following Christ, not just saying it, like this is the guy said, I will follow you wherever you go, but I don't see him following him anymore after this. You know, maybe he did. I hope he did, but it doesn't really mention him after that. So for all we know, it's just some guy who said, I'll follow you wherever you go. And Jesus said this, you know, this little saying, which basically means it's going to be tough. And then the guy just, he didn't follow him. Or maybe he did. We don't know. But the point is that Jesus is telling you right here, it's going to be tough. It's going to be hard. You're not going to fit in the world. You're going to be lost. You're going to be like a fish out of water. Put it that way. You're going to be, you know, in the world, but not of the world. That's what it is. And you might not like it. So it might not be what you're thinking it's going to be. You know, follow Jesus wherever he goes. I mean, he's headed to the cross and everything. He's not, it's maybe not what they thought it was going to be, right? It's like, I mean, you got preachers today, they just love to preach. And you got a lot of people who want to be preachers. Maybe they think it's kind of a prestigious kind of thing. Wouldn't it be great to get up there and just, you know, speak with authority and tell people what's what, and they have to listen to you and respect you and all that. Well, a lot of people think that that's what preaching is like, and it's really not. To be a preacher, you got to be called by God. And one way you'll know that you're called by God is that you wouldn't be happy doing anything else. You're going to be preaching no matter what. And it's just like so many things about your life are just going to be focused on that, on, well, preaching or ministry in general, whatever it is. You're not just doing it for the fanfare. You're doing it because something deep inside you is just making you do it. And you're not going to be satisfied until you do. You're going to be restless until you do it, until you just get that off your chest. You got to get it out. You got to proclaim the gospel, proclaim the kingdom of God. You know, Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. And you gotta let people know. There's so much ignorance out there. Ignorance. I don't mean to say that in a mean way. I'm just saying there's a lot of a lack of understanding about the Bible and everything else. So there's a great need for ministers, preachers, wherever you're at. You know, the harvest is plentiful. The laborers are few. But like what I was talking about, preachers, you know, they want to do it as a job, as a prestigious job that people look up to, it's kind of honor, at least within that church. Would you do it if you were not getting paid? Would you do it if you were being persecuted, right, you're not receiving back anything out of it. It's just but suffering and long hours of work and very little fanfare, you know. Are you still going to be doing it? You know, and I'm not just talking about preaching. I'm talking about following Jesus. You don't follow Jesus because you think it makes you feel good. You don't follow Jesus because it's acceptable in your family and they're going to look up to you. Those are not the right kinds of reasons. Are you willing to follow Jesus no matter what, wherever he goes, no matter how hard it gets? And, you know, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. But the kind of life, it's a completely upside down life to follow Jesus. And I wouldn't have it any other way. You know, when you have that peace that surpasses all understanding, that joy in the Holy Spirit that comes from having a relationship, a fellowship with God. And so you're going to be happy. You're going to be filled with joy. That's more than just happy. You're not just happy. You're filled with joy, unspeakable joy from knowing God, having a purpose in life and knowing that, you know, things may be hard. Things are going to be hard in the world, but we're okay with that. You know, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And we know that God causes all things to work together for our good. So, verse 59, and he said to another, follow me. But he said, Lord, permit me first to go and bury my father. But he said to him, allow the dead to bury their own dead. But as for you, go and proclaim everywhere the kingdom of God. Wow. I remember this one. Even since I was a kid, this little passage here, I always thought it was funny. It almost comes across as kind of, you know, in the English translation here, it comes across as kind of rude almost. You know what I mean? Sounds like this poor guy wants to follow Jesus, but he just wants to bury his father. So what, is his father dead? Well, guess what? There's a kind of a cultural saying here. We talk about burying my father. And this is missed a lot of times in the English translations. If you get a good study Bible, you know, it might have some notes on this, but it was a saying, let me bury my father. It's not saying that his father is already dead and he just needs to be buried. Basically, what he's most likely talking about, using the language of, you know, this manner of speech of the time, he's saying his father's alive and well, but he wants to stay taking care of his father at his home until he does die, and then bury him, and then he'll follow Jesus. So that puts a different spin on it, doesn't it? So, I mean, in those days, when someone died, they would be buried right away, generally within 2 hours. So they didn't wait around days or a week or anything to hold a funeral. It was immediate. They buried him right away. And so he wouldn't be out here talking to Jesus if his father was actually dead. He would be proceeding to bury him. So he's really talking about, yeah, I'll follow you, but let me do something else first. You know, wait till the right time in my life, and then I'm going to come after Jesus. And that was a big mistake. That doesn't work. When Jesus said, allow the dead to bury their own dead. But as for you, go and proclaim everywhere the kingdom of God. Well, Jesus called him out. I think maybe, you know, it might have worked. This is one that Jesus said to the guy, follow me. So Jesus picked a guy out of the crowd and said, follow me. And then the guy was like, well, first I need to do this. And Jesus is like, no. Allow the dead to bury the dead. As for you, go and proclaim everywhere the kingdom of God. Sounds like Jesus knew this guy. Sounds like this was the guy that needed to go out and proclaim the kingdom of God. So hopefully he got saved. It certainly shows you, you know, the principle there. The principle is that, I mean, you cannot just Well, you cannot just take God at your own terms. You know what I mean? You cannot just say, I will follow you, but first I need to do this. You don't even know that you're going to even be here tomorrow. You know, today could be your last day on earth. So you really cannot delay eternal life for anything. You have to decide right now, right here and right now. And a lot of people, they did put it off, but then what happened is, you know, God gives them a lot of chances for most people, but you don't know how many chances you're going to get, and it makes no sense to put it off. I mean, and maybe I haven't heard it in a while, but when I was a kid, when I was young, I'd say early teenage or whatever, you know, I used to hear a lot, you know, I would talk about Christianity. Okay, I would talk about Christianity or being a Christian or something, you know. Now, I wasn't even that, you know, knowledgeable about it at that time. And I wasn't really that close to God at that time either. I was kind of close. I still prayed and I still felt God was hearing my prayers and all that. But if I ever try to talk to another kid about that, I remember they would say something like, oh, you're too young for that, right? Maybe now's the time to have fun, right? Now's the time to have fun, and later you get old, then you can get into all that, right? I don't know. I just thought I'd bring that up. It's been so long, so many years since I've heard something like that. But that's the kind of stuff that we're faced with. And that's the kind of attitude that is out there. People think, people just have the wrong idea. It means they just don't know God. If they knew God, they would know it's not a drag to follow God. It's not like ruining your fun, spoiling your fun. You're still having a lot of fun when you're a Christian. It's a different kind. You know, we're not having fun rebelling against God. Now what's fun to us is to follow God and to get involved with what he's doing. So it's a different, just totally different mindset. And again, you don't know how many days you got. So to put it off like that is incredibly foolish. And I'm telling you, not many people are going to make it. Not many people are going to be saved. And so you don't want to be falling into one of these categories of people that just doesn't make the cut. If you're going to be saved, you need to decide to excel and to make sure that you're going to be saved. You know, what do you mean excel? You're not just like sitting back and just saying, okay, wishy-washy, maybe later, maybe this, maybe that. You got to make sure. You got to do everything you can do to make sure that you be saved, right? And there's nothing you can really do but put your faith in Jesus Christ. And then, you know, but doing that, a real faith in Jesus Christ will drive you to action. And you're going to welcome the Holy Spirit into your life. And that is going to equip you and empower you for action. So anyway, there was that. And allow the dead to bury their own dead. I believe he's talking about spiritually dead. You know, so some of those people were not even Christians. They're not even going to be saved, probably. And so why waste your time, you know, comforting people who are not even going to be saved? Well, we don't know who's going to be saved, but Jesus knew. So he was able to say that. Allow the dead to bury their own dead. It's not even worth it. It's like these people are not going to, they're not even saved. They're not going to even be saved. So these people are lost. And so you have more important things to tend to. You know, with your one life to live, you're going to spend your time on what? What are you going to be following? God? Are you going to be following Jesus? Or are you going to be sidetracked by the world? And we're all sidetracked by the world, for sure. It's just like that. But we got to make the decision. As Christians, we're going to overcome, you know. Again, the verse, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. So we're going to overcome by the blood of the Lamb, by the Holy Spirit living in us, and that's going to allow us to live this new life in Jesus. And thank God. The next verse, 61. Another also said, "I will follow you, Lord, but first permit me to say goodbye to those at home." Verse 62, but Jesus said to him, "No one, after putting his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God." Can't look back. You got to leave what's behind you and press on forward to the prize, the goal, the high calling in Christ Jesus. And, you know, this saying, put your hand to the plow and looking back. I've heard it like if you're plowing a field, and you're trying to plow straight lines through the field. You would look at like a landmark off in the distance, and as you were plowing, you would go like straight to that landmark. It could be just a stake that you hammered into the ground, and so as you plow, you want to make a straight line. You're going to keep going straight at that stake. Okay. Now, if you're plowing, and you keep looking back, all right? You keep looking back. Why do you do that? You know, your lines are not going to be straight if you keep looking back. You need to look where you're going. What would be the point of looking backwards? So it's very profound what he said. And that was a great example about plowing. Now, it was familiar to them back then. A lot of them were working in fields, plowing and all this. So speaking to them in a way that they understand. And it's just about not looking back, you know. Once you have stepped over from, you know, death into life, why would you look back? Why would you keep going back to your old ways? And no one who puts his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. That sounds harsh. It sounds scary a little bit. I mean, I know I've backslidden before in my life. I was saved. I was filled with the Holy Spirit. And over time, I don't know what happened, but I slowly began to compromise in some areas. I didn't have a very good theological understanding at that time. So I thought it was okay to you know, to slip up and make mistakes, and God's going to forgive you anyway. Well, there's a name for that. It's called antinomianism. Okay, fancy word I learned in Bible college. But it's the idea that, you know, it's the opposite of legalism. So legalism is like you feel like you have to follow every law or you're not going to make it. Antinomianism is like you don't even care about the laws. You do whatever you want. As long as you have faith in Jesus, you're going to make it. Well, it's true that having faith in Jesus is all that it takes to make it, right? But when you have that faith in Jesus, that will change your life, and God will not leave you in that place. So backsliding is not good, but I'm telling you, God will not leave you in that place. He'll make sure, okay? So no one, after putting his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God in this example. Again, it comes down to the heart. I mean, even when I was backsliding and all that, my heart was still with God. I was still praying to God. And if I sinned, I felt bad and I prayed for forgiveness. And I was just not doing it the right way. I wasn't living a great Christian life at that time, you know, talking years ago when I was a younger Christian. But I wasn't rebelling against God. I was not. I still kept my faith in Jesus, and I still believed. And so, and then I wasn't that comfortable there too. And I felt God calling me back. And it was so beautiful one day when I finally answered that call and realized, yeah, I need to get closer to God. You know, I have faith in God, but I need to get closer. And I just missing those times before. Like when I was in New York, how close with God I was, and how big into the church and everything. It's just that Holy Spirit feeling. It's that electricity in you. It's that feeling of like pure love. It's godly love that nothing you can. Your heart just melts. I don't even know how else to describe it. It's like this energy, and it's just this love of God that you feel, and that it just takes over into where you straighten up and you get back on track. Now that's a different thing. I was not rebelling against God exactly. But, you know, where exactly is the line? You know, God is the judge. He knows the motive of your heart and everything. No, there's justice, right? Like, he knows the letter of the law. God knows the spirit of the law, too. If you're just trying to get away with something, or if you're legitimately seeking after God and you just made some mistakes, well, you're still here, so you're still alive, so it's not too late to clean up your life. And at any rate, God's not judging us based on our mistakes when we have faith in Jesus Christ. We're being judged based on our faith in Jesus Christ. Do we have faith in Jesus Christ? Then we're saved. And all of our sins are washed away. And at the judgment, we'll be rewarded for the things that we do in Christ. But that being said, like I say, God doesn't just leave you there. He's leading you. He's guiding you. He'll make things happen in your life to draw you back. He will make it happen. And thank God for that. You know, we could not do it on our own at all. The Christian life, the Christian walk, it says follow Jesus, right? It's about following Jesus. And, you know, he kept saying, follow me. Well, follow Jesus. That means we're not just finding our own way through the world on our own, going to where we think Jesus would want us to go. We're actually following Jesus, right? So he's the one leading us and guiding us. And that's the way it works. And so there's that relationship with God, relationship with Jesus, to where we can see, you know, him and where he's going, and that way we can follow him. And that happens through the Holy Spirit, and God makes it happen. So, yeah, another comment about this, about the whole section here. You know, what's common to all of these? Where, you know, you had the one guy, he was kind of boasting. He said, I'll follow you wherever you go. And he didn't even know what he was saying. He's just boasting. It's about me. He said, I'll follow you wherever you go. He had the confidence in himself that he could do it. And then another one said, Jesus told him, follow me. And then he said, Lord, permit me first to go and bury my father. Permit me first. Okay. And then another one, he said, another also said in verse 61, I will follow you, Lord, but first permit me to say goodbye to those at home. First me, right? That's the problem in here. It's self-centered in all of these. These people, they didn't get it yet. Now, we can hope and pray. Well, I mean, it's too late for them. Their decision has already been made. But for us, we can hope and pray that we make the right decision and be saved, right? But where they were at this point was not so good, because it was a self-centered attitude. It was a confidence in their own self, as the first example, boasting of his own ability to follow Jesus without even counting the cost. And then the other ones are basically saying, where Jesus calls them out, Jesus is calling them, and they still say, but permit me first, you know, me first. Permit me to first go and bury my father. Permit me to, you know, first permit me to go say goodbye to those at home. So it's a self-centered thing. You're putting Christ lower than your own will and desire. It's like you want to follow Christ, but only on your own terms. That's what I'm trying to say. And that doesn't work. And that, I can guarantee you, that doesn't work. You are not going to be able to follow Jesus Christ on your own terms. Something's going to happen. And that is not going to work. Something's going to happen. For a lot of people, you know, they just have this self-centered attitude. And they want to be in control of everything, including their relationship with God. They feel I will follow Jesus if I get this or that, you know, if it makes me happy, if it makes, you know, my family happy, and, you know, putting these conditions, I'll do it if this, if that, if I get this, if I get that. It's all centered on myself, and it's missing it completely. And these kind of people, I believe, you know, you're not gonna know Christ like that. But the people who do know Christ, God will shake you up and wake you up, and something's gonna happen. Hallelujah. Something is gonna happen in your life, and you're gonna get to the point to where you're no longer thinking me first. You know, for a lot of people, they gotta get down to the, you know, they gotta hit rock bottom to where they feel like they've just lost it. They have no control over their life. It's falling apart. They feel like they might be going to hell. You know, these kind of weird feelings can be good. It wakes you up. It draws you back to Jesus. Or some tragedy in your life, tragically, can happen, and it can draw you back to Jesus. But God is going to do something, and something's going to change in you to where it's you first, Jesus Christ. You're the one who's first. And it's, Lord, have mercy on me. Okay, I'm a sinner, and but I believe, and Lord, help me with my unbelief. So that humble submission to Jesus Christ, with the priority, with Jesus first, and we're not gonna let anything stand in the way. Jesus Christ is first in my life. He really is. I mean, I'm not saying I do everything perfect. I make a lot of mistakes too. I'm a regular human being like anyone. But Jesus Christ, I believe, yeah, he is first in my life. And I do have the Holy Spirit in me. And how can I say Jesus Christ first? Do I put him first in everything? Is he in all things? Is he preeminent? I wish he was. And like I said, I'm just human, so I can't boast and say that. But I say that, you know, he's always on my mind. God is always on my mind. I'm following him. I'm living the life that I'm supposed to live, you know, and trying to, but I'm working at it. And I feel pretty good about it, you know. I know I can study the word. I can feel, you know, I can feel the Spirit of God in me. And when you feel the Spirit of God in you, you know that you can't be that far off track. And if I ever was aware of something, some situation that was standing in between me and God, I would have to put a stop to that immediately, because Jesus Christ is truly the most important thing. And we can only have salvation through him. So it's just like that. And we got to lay everything down. We got to lay it all down. You know, it doesn't mean we can't have those things. We still get to visit with our family. You know, we don't just have to like walk out on them and follow Jesus. We still get to visit them. But if it becomes a crutch, then it needs to go. It needs to go. But we're going to follow him. We're going to sacrifice things. You know, we're going to sacrifice a lot of things to follow Jesus. And we're going to have to. You have to deny yourself and take up your cross and follow Jesus. And you know what? He did the same thing for you. Jesus Christ was the ultimate example of that. He had everything. He has everything. He is God. He is the Creator. He is the Word. You know, the Word that spoke and the universe leapt into existence. All things were created through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Jesus Christ made everything. He is God, right? He is the Word of God. He is God the Son. He has all power and all glory, and humbled himself to come down as a man and to suffer, right? To suffer, to be mocked, to be beaten, scourged, and crucified, and he lost everything. Well, I mean, everything in the world, even his disciples abandoned him at his time of need, right? In the Garden of Gethsemane and on the cross, right? But he did it on purpose. He knew that that was going to happen. He willingly did it. He did it out of love for you because that was the only way to save you. And just that incredible example of Christ, right? If he can do it, and if we're following him, then we need to do it. And what he did in a great big way, we're doing in a smaller way, but we're still doing it. We're denying ourselves. We're not living a self-centered life. We're putting ourselves, you know, humble, being more humble and lifting up Christ, you know, and then letting our lives be a reflection of him so that others can be drawn to Jesus Christ. And we, as we do this, we're facing suffering, we're facing persecution in various ways, but we're doing that willingly, and it's out of love. It's the love that God has that's just rubbed off on us, right? Because we've been spending time with him, and it just rubs off on you. That's what I say. God's love in you, it just reflects off you into other people. And it happens in small ways, but it can happen in big ways too. And we're doing it because we want other people to be saved so that they can enjoy eternity with us and with God in heaven, because it's going to be great. So yeah, that's a lot of stuff that we need to think about. And let's just pray about it. Almighty God, thank you, God, this message, this sermon. Just please, God, help us, you know, help us to be humble and to not put ourselves first, but to put Christ first. And that's, boy, that can be hard to do sometimes. Our human nature just keeps acting up, and we need your help. We pray for your help. We pray for you to fill us with the Holy Spirit so that the love of Christ can just be manifest in us and reflecting on us and off of us, spreading to other people. And help us, God, to have that close relationship with you, God, to where we know that we are fit for the kingdom of God because you have shown it to us, because you have filled us with the Holy Spirit. And that gives us confidence to know that our name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life and that we will be saved. And then just help us with our weaknesses. You know, we believe, God, we have faith in you. We believe in Jesus. We believe, but help us with our unbelief and help us with our stubborn selves, you know, to overcome our bad habits and to replace them with good habits so that we can be more useful for you, God, in advancing the kingdom of God. And we pray for this and we thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen.